This is Sniper signing in to Command & Conquer Red Alert 3 on the map. I don't know this map name. It has been a little bit since I've actually recorded. More on that in just a minute. But since I don't remember the map name, introducing the players spawning as the orange Soviet player, this is H2O Chris. And his opponent spawning as the blue Empire player, currently defending his title of King of the Hill, as this is from the King of the Hill series. This is Never Smurf, aka Andre. Andre going for that double ref blue Empire color. I'm digging the color blue. Chris playing his very typical orange Soviets. Seems like every time I see Chris play, he is on his orange Soviets. Nothing wrong about that at all. Orange, very, very nice color for the Soviets. Very nice job also garrisoning these little structures just dotted around his base just to help defend against the harass that the Empire player could indeed put out. Now, a little bit more about where I've been for the past few weeks. Well, the past 2 weeks, they were hectic, right? They were more headache-inducing than I ever thought they would have been. So, to put it simply, a lot of family things came up, a lot of personal things came up really, really quickly and really close to one another. So what was only supposed to last, you know, two, maybe 3 days in terms of the original break that I had, it suddenly just kind of grew. It grew and grew and grew. And next thing I know, I moved back down to university, which if you hear a little bit of an echo in the background, that is because I am currently in a not so soundproof room or not so sound absorbent room. So it's going to echo quite a bit, unfortunately. So I do apologize in advance for that. But yeah, that I did move back down here over the course of these past couple of weeks, and I've gotten resituated now. I think the personal things have finally subsided. I think they're done. I'm saying they're done. I'm calling them done. They're done and dusted, and now we can get back to a little bit of normalcy by getting some recording on the cards, as the action's already picking up from Andre trying to get in there and do a little bit of harassment when and where he can, but it just wasn't quite happening because of now that flag trooper's gonna have to run. You see, now he was trying to get in here with Tengus, right? He's trying to get in here with Tengus so that he could do some harvester harass, or collector harass rather. His harvesters, that's Tiberium Wars. And then going in for the collector harass, but since Chris garrisoned these buildings, then he was not quite able to do so. That's very pixelated. I can see some pixels right there. Trying to come in for some harassment. We did see Andre grab the garage here in the bottom right hand corner of the map. I still don't know what map name this is. This is kind of bad. I'll throw that in the description somewhere. Or I'll mention it somewhere along the lines. But that with that garage under Andre's control, that will allow his Tengus to receive constant and continuous repairs. Very, very useful indeed. Tengu just trying to get a little bit of damage off here, but I think the flak trooper can out-damage the garage, which yes, indeed it is. The flak trooper is definitely out-damaging that garage. And these Imperial Warriors just KO'd an oil derrick. So now, note that's 15 cred error every 2 seconds less that Chris is going to be getting as opposed to Andre. Looking back at the bases, we're still sitting on a T1 mecha bay. This could very well become a T2 mecha bay, as that is researching, or that is building very, very slowly. So I would not be shocked at all. That is a mecha bay upgrade, which indeed it was. So will we see some tsunami tanks? More than likely. Tsunami tanks are a very mainstay, or very mainline frontline unit for the Empire. I would not doubt it at all if we were to see some tsunami tanks. Andre doing a very nice job here, getting his Imperial Warriors into the structures around. Oh, and now some tank busters too. Oh, this super reactor is too far forward. Chris, this super reactor is too far forward. It's gonna get slagged. But, oh, never, no, it's not. Never mind. Chris has conscripts. It's all good. He has war bears to negate the Imperial Warrior. Tried to run it away, but war bears will take care of any of the infantry that are currently out. I don't know, does he see that one? Yeah, he sees it. He definitely sees that one. That infantry push is going to get cleaned up. Oh, that's where they're coming from. There's a dojo ref block. The dojo refinery block over here. So no refinery can go down on that third location. But it doesn't matter because Chris has already moved his MCV over to the double expansion here. Already has one refinery established working on the second. And a Tesla coil already down for defense. I am digging that very, very much. Third ref only just now started for Andre. No, that's a fourth. That is a fourth. I need to pay more attention to the map. I really need to pay more attention to the map. That is a fourth. Okay, so now fourth refinery is on its way for Andre. So things will get a little bit more even. Now, Chris is going to have to get a little creative here, right? He's facing pressure that's keeping a lot of his stuff in the base. But I guess the bullfrogs and the hammer tank, they just kind of just roll right on by it. And without really having to worry too much about anything at all. These two Chopper VXs are going to be enough to take down this Tesla coil before those reinforcements can arrive. So now, harvesting is completely stopped. Tengu, as long as Andre's paying attention, which I think he's going to lose one chopper, but he's going to trade it for a bullfrog. One hammer tank is going to come down, but as long as this bullfrog stays alive, that one remaining chopper VX cannot come in here to take down that hammer tank. It just cannot and will not happen. And as such, Andre is forced away, got both of the harvesters both of the collectors into the yellow health, but now Chopper VXs are rolling back up, three this time, two more have rejoined that lone survivor from the initial push, looks like a fourth, yes, a fourth one is coming up, you're gonna want to be careful about that. That is something I've always found a little odd, or a little peculiar, right? A chopper just doing a blatant reverse move, right? Like, just like stopping on a dime and just going backwards, just like flying straight backwards. I've always just found that kind of humorous about this sort of game. But as when I think about, you know, actual reality-based games, you know, like Battlefield or amongst other Arma or other things, it's just kind of humorous. But anyway, that has no bearing on this game whatsoever. Looks like Chris was able to fully clean up all of the harass that Andre had going his way towards his base. With all of that harass gone and out of the picture, well, now as I say that, a little bit more harass does come over in the form of two Mecha Tengus, but the flak troopers are going to be able to grab this garrison little structure as it still stands. And I think Chris may very well be pulling, or may be in the process of being pulled apart here. Oh, no, there is a flat cannon. Okay, there is a flat cannon here that's going to cover at least this collector. It should cover this collector mildly. I think that that Andre will actually be able to snipe that one without losing his air units, should he so try. Fifth refinery online for Andre, still only the four for Chris. Only the four for Chris. Then now it looks like Chris does indeed have a garage now, so his vehicles will be benefiting from those repairs from the garage. Very nice thing to have. And right, maybe I committed too early in saying that Chris was being pulled apart. It looks quite the opposite right now. Andre is in a fantastic economic position, but Chris is bouncing back. Chris's army can't be matched right now. Andre does not have the resources available to match it. Not blow for blow. Well, Oh, he is not. Oh, Andre, you sneaky, sneaky. Sneaky, sneaky little dink. He was going to try. He's going to try and do a ninja cap on the War Factory, but Chris was paying attention. And folks, a little bit of a pro tip. If you're ever going to try and engineer cap anything, really, in Red Alert 3, if you're ever going to try engineer cap it, give your opponent something else to think about while you do it, right? Distract your opponent, like launch some kind of diversionary attack, and something else you don't want to do, well, tsunami tanks can rectify this, you don't want to just leave your tank busters to basically fend for themselves against a whole bunch of war bears. That would not be good. Got to get those tank busters to take down those hammer tanks, but those war bears will just come through and just start carving through the lines of tank busters. Oh, it's a really nice roar off, and here comes the crush move. Since they can't move, that's all of the tank busters going to be dead. All of them are now dead. And I do, yes, that is a heroic hammer tank with all of these little miniature repair icons. They both have a garage, so they effectively negate each other. But the DPS, Andre is just feeding his units right now. The DPS is too great for Chris right now. Losing all those tank busters, Andre needs to abandon this position. He needs to fall the flip back. There's nothing he can do to hold it, and as such, he sells the dojo and is just going to move on. Can he send out some chopper VX to try and do a little bit of air harass? Possibly, yes, he can range that refinery without getting in range of that flak cannon, but that's what the barracks is for. The barracks will spit out some flak troopers that will take down those chopper VXs. Now, looking at this tit for tat, five tsunami tanks, a handful of Imperial infantry, roughly 12 tank busters thereabout. The 12 tank busters, that's enough to one shot. Yeah, I think you needed like 6 or 7 to one shot a hammer tank. So that's, oh, he's gonna want to be careful about this one. Oh, does he see it? Does he see it? It gets the roar off. That's all that matters. He needs to move his tanks to the front line right now, and he needs to block the enemy hammer tanks from coming in. He's just gonna crush all the Imperial infantry again. They all get crushed with all of those Imperial infantry crushed. Now these tsunami tanks, they don't have the firepower to match up against tsunami zero attacking the heroic tank. That's a good target, but the heroic tank just soaks up too much damage. Soaks up way too much damage. And now I think that's gonna be the unkindest cut of all, so to speak. I think that is going to mark the end. He's building a wave force tower. That is a wave force tower. How often do you actually see a stinking wave force tower? You know the Empire player is getting desperate if he's building wave force towers. You never see wave force towers anywhere. I think you even see ally players build spectrum towers more often than you see a wave force tower go down. Oh my goodness. Yeah, no. Wave force towers, they're usually an act of desperation whenever I'm playing Empire. But, they're good. They're powerful, but it's just perhaps not in the medium that, or not in the way that they're needed to be right now. Because right now, this many hammer tanks just had two heroic tanks, as a matter of fact. Two more already going veteran. This many tanks is just, there's not a whole bunch that can really be done. This wave force tower does complete, so that is an extra line of defense that is complete. Oh, wait a minute, that didn't dawn on me. He does have a nanotech mainframe, and he was upgrading to T3. King Oni are on the map. Now, this changes things. Now, if a couple of King Oni come out and if Andre fights around this wave force tower, then things could be substantially different. Do we have any sort of answering tech coming out? We have an airfield coming out from Chris. Do I have a battle lab? I don't think we do. No, we don't. No battle lab. Pardon me. I just ate a little bit of lunch. But if we don't get a battle lab out from Chris, I mean, the Tesla troopers are going to be a nice touch. Yes, that would be a very nice touch. But if you don't get a battle lab out, then there's going to be no real... Oh, he's got Yuriko. There's really no answer for that now. Coming, this army here, the Tesla troopers, if the Tesla troopers, Terra drone, and these, like, this little front clump, one drone and five infantry units, if those went down, if it was just the hammer tanks, I mean, he's outmatched. Alright, Chris is outmatched pretty badly right now. That's a trade Chris will be liking to see. One conscript for one Imperial warrior, that definitely favors the Soviet, because the conscript's only like $100. Like, only $100 to build, whereas the Imperial Warriors are like 200 or 250. I don't know. I don't remember. I don't remember how expensive they are. I want to. Yuriko. Is she gonna die? Oh, she gonna die now. If that Twin Blade goes after her, she gonna die now. Oh, Tesla Trooper. You can see this coming from a mile away. Andre, and now two of his King Oni are locked down. Two of them are locked down. There's nothing he can do about it because this other Tesla Trooper would just zone them out. And if he try, oh, Chris is gonna bring up the Terra Drone. He's gonna lock them. He's gonna try and micro lock them. I wonder if he force fires the ground. Oh, he's trying to. Oh, Chris. Oh, that's nice. That is very nice, micro Chris. Taking full advantage of this Terra Drone and his shot claws. means that now, instead of just killing two King Oni, he's going to kill four. All four of those King Oni are going to fall. That means only two King Oni remain, along with some Striker VXs back in the base. Did he sell his Conyard? Yes, he did. There's the Engineer. Conyard has been sold. He's back on only one base, two ref, and those two ref are going to be running out of money very soon. I think the writing is almost on the wall on this one. I think it's almost there. The writing is just, it's almost completely over, I think. These two King Oni, they're going to try something, but he does wind up killing that Terra Drone. That's a nice plus, but now that Terra Drone is just going to sit here and lock them down. Chris's micro is just too good. He's just going to sit here and lock them down completely, and now that's going to be the end. That's the end, all right, of these Ohello. That's the end of these King Onis, possibly on the ground, but that means these Chopper VXs. Andre, you need to be attacking right now. Be attacking. All these Hammer Tanks are definitely in some dire straits right now. That's bad. That is so bad. If you're ever chasing Bullfrogs with Chopper VXs, they have, like, paper for armor. That is so, 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 so bad. Did I call it too early again? Andre's gonna stick with it. He's going to keep attacking. There are MiGs. MiGs are on their way out. He needs to finish these Hammer Tanks before those MiGs show up. But there's a ton of Twin Blades. There's a ton of Twin Blades. There's two MiGs now. He does have some Tengus coming up. But will all of those MiGs die before the Choppers do? I don't think so. They did, but... Oh my goodness, this is such a scrappy little game. Flank troopers, there's three heroic flank troopers on the ground. War Factory destroyed all of those Hammer Tanks, just absolutely wasted. What do we have now? Well, that one Chopper VX is coming over here. He's going to see if he can take down the Conyard. He might be able to do it. He's got flank troopers running up from behind, but I don't know. He might be able to do it. He just might be able to... He will not be able to do it. He's gonna have to... he's just gonna commit. That is a bad idea. That transform the MCV is very good, because now the MCV will get free repairs. It's very, very nice transform. And now those flag troopers will wind up chasing away everything. Oh, man, everything. Andre, I think that was his last shot to really pull it out of this game. I really think it was. He's sitting on 47, about to be 45. You have 4,500-ish per ref. That's not very much to work with. I think he's trying to rebuild a Yuriko Omega, but nothing coming out of the Mecha Bay, not even another MCV. And now, the Yuriko does come out, but I think that is an orbital dump. Yes, that is indeed, but that might catch Yuriko. That's gonna hurt Yuriko. Didn't wind up killing the dojo, so that's a plus. Did not kill the dojo, but now we have one King Oni that tried to slip in and attack the MCV. But now, that's the thing with playing Soviets. You always have to look out. Always, always, always look out for the Terra Drone. Because if the Terra Drones get you, they'll zap you right out of the game. As we see there, Andre tapping out. He really had nowhere to go with that one at all. That was still very nicely played by both these players, but it's just this engagement from Andre. Just you can see by how the unit's graph moves, and Andre or Chris's unit count only drops a little bit. Andre's, it falls off a cliff, and then hits a few more bumps on the way down. And he never was really able to recover, never able to, again, match the kind of units that Chris had on the map. And oddly enough, Andre did have the economic advantage for the longest time. He had the eco advantage because it was 5 refs to 4. At its highest point for Andre, it was 5 refs to 4. 5 refs to 4, that's going to very easily tip the scales in favor of Andre. Relative to the time it was in the game, Andre had the advantage, but in the overall scheme, because he lost 3 of those refs right around here, it started to flatline a little bit, right? And now suddenly that proportion gets a lot closer. And so now, 5,000 to 49.90, 90K to 89K, that is just dead even in terms of eco. For an 18-minute game, it's just completely dead even. And I think Andre just didn't take as good of engagements as Chris did. And I think Andre losing his infantry ball the same way twice, that's what did it. He lost the infantry ball the same way to a war bear's amplified roar ability that's stunning all of those infantry and just allowing the hammer tanks just to come in willy-nilly and just crush absolutely everything. That, I would say, easily lost Andre that game, but nevertheless, it is time with the end of game number one to jump straight into game number two, which brings us to the map Fire Island, spawning as the orange Soviets player on the top side, currently up 1-0 in this series. This is H2O Chris, and his opponent spawning as the blue Empire player, currently down 0-1 rather on the bottom side. This is Neversmurf, aka Andre, and I did find out the name of the map from last map that I could not remember once we actually got into the game. That was Grinder Gulch. I should have remembered that one because I think I remembered playing on that map in Red Alert 3 Uprising. I think it was that map back. Yeah, was it that map? Was it that map that they threw all the grinders at you in Uprising? I think it was. I want to say it was. A little bit of Crush Core action trying to come out here, but War Bears and Flak Troops already on it. Chris is just going to destroy it. He's just going to destroy it. He's just saying, nope, not even gonna bother with the oil derricks. He's just gonna blow up he's just gonna destroy the derricks. No one's gonna take them. If now Andre, if he wants to get that 500 worth, he has to book it to the other derrick before. Does he have any other flak troopers? No, he doesn't, okay. I bet he predicted that Andre was gonna go for this derrick, and since he more than likely had those war bears ahead of the flank troopers, and once he spotted the dojo, he's like, oh, okay, so he's gonna go straight for that derrick, I'm gonna go ahead and just blow it up. But now the problem is, though, with this map being symmetrical, that means this engineer he could just sprint it on over and capture this derrick, and boom, 500 right back in the pocket of Andre. Those little pack of war bears are going to go see what kind of scouting they can get done. If these Imperial warriors are just allowed to, like, just get into the base, if they were allowed to just get in here and just do whatever in the world they wanted, you know, they would eventually destroy something, I'm sure. I'm sure they would eventually destroy something. First Tengu already out. What kind of response do we have from Chris? It looks like he's just going to go straight for hammer tanks. Super Reactor is already out on the map. Going to be grabbing some of those hammer tanks more than likely. And we have an MCV cell. All right, Andre is going. He's going in. He's going all the chips on the table, and it gets spotted immediately. It gets spotted immediately, and now Chris is just going to follow it. Chris can just follow. There's no use disguising it now because the war bears could sniff it out. The war bears could just easily sniff out whatever it was that he was trying to do. Oh, the MCV is forward. He could go. He's going to go. Andre's going to take his infantry and try to engage his MCV. It's already preemptively packed up. Good call on Chris. He's going to go ahead and get the MCV out of there. He needs to get that MCV out of there. It was in some serious danger being in that position. He has now recognizing the threat of Imperial infantry impending down upon him. Sickles are coming out of that Soviet war factory, going to make things a lot harder for Andre to make this infantry push work. I don't see this infantry push working, to be quite honest. I just don't see it. I mean, if he tries to get inside the wall and get inside of the ore line, then there's a terror drone waiting for him, right? There's a terror drone waiting to greet him. You have a sickle already just ready and waiting to possibly. Oh, there's a T2 switch up. T2 switch up. Chopper VXs are out. Only two bullfrogs are on the map. Oh, you got to be careful. If those sickles try and just try to go in for one of those Kobe jumps in, if they try it, then Chopper VX is going to just. Oh, it was a nice scatter move. Now he just needs to turn and fight. He needs to turn and fight with everything that he's got now. Does manage to KO one of them. KOs two. That terror drone's being a problem. It needs to go down. There we go. Terror drone does go down, but there's so many dead infantry here. There's only two tank busters left. I don't think that's really enough. Okay, that hammer tank actually could have gotten some nice crushes off, but just kind of didn't. Could have gotten indeed some very nice crushes off. And now, all that terror drone! The terror drone! There was a terror drone! And that is going to be it. That is the end of this infantry push. It is over and it is done. Is that an MCV? I think that's an MCV. Yeah, it's building way too slowly. That isn't definitely an MCV. No, it's not. He's just cash stalled. Andre's just stalled for cash. He has two Dutch Andre. He's trying to make this work. He has one Chopper VX left up here. He's trying to make something or another happen with it. But I just don't see it happening. I do not see it at all. Chris, I think he's in a commanding position thanks to that infantry ball just kind of dying. since Andre, if that infantry ball had worked, I mean, being an Empire player myself, I'll vouch for it. And using infantry against Soviets, good luck, buddy. I mean, I've seen plenty of people make it work, but it's just if the Soviet player sniffs it out and is able to get the appropriate counters up, then suddenly your job gets a lot harder. It gets exponentially harder. Like with every sickle that comes out, or every terror drone, your job gets exponentially harder. Very, very bad indeed. Still just sticking to his guns, making some Tengus and possibly some more Strikers. He does, there we go. Two Chopper VXs out, three Tengus out between Jet and Mecha mode. But now, what is he gonna do now? Loses another Tengu here in the center of the map, and I just don't feel as though he's really got a plan. Oh, there used to be an MCV here. It's gone now. I'm gonna guess that he probably sold it. Maybe. I'm gonna guess that he probably sold the MCV. kind of hoping that was the case and didn't just get blown up. Because, you know, it would have been, that would probably explain how he was able to get the cash boost that he had to mass pump so many cycles at once. But now, Andre's recovering. Andre is starting to recover. He's starting to recover, and I mean, it's still two ref to two ref. You know, T2 versus T2, neither player has an MCV right now. so if any damage these guys take is permanent. Any damage they take is completely permanent right now. In terms of structures, it is completely and utterly permanent. Does wind up losing one sickle. Bullfrogs are in range. You want to pull those out of range. Oh, you want to pull those out of range. You want to get out of there. Get out of there. I guess you could have sacrificed your remaining units if you really wanted to kill that ref, which actually that might have been worth it since there's no way for him to rebuild it right now. That not killing that ref may actually come back to be very, very important, not killing that ref. I think it would have made more sense if he was just going to suicide his Tengu on top of the refinery. And now three sickles, two terror drones, two hammer tanks, two bullforks against a lot of tank busters. Well, that's a hard bargain. That's a really hard bargain. It's like you have the hard counter. Two units hard counter each other, right? Tank busters hard counter vehicles. Like pretty much any vehicle is really hard countered by a tank buster. But then sickles are also, I think, the best of between the three factions, right? Between the Riptide ACV, the Mecha Tengu, and the sickle in terms of damage output. I'm pretty sure sickle is the best in terms of DPS, right? So no, having all of those sickles, that's gonna be a pretty big help. But since there's no repairs on this war factory, like there are on their allied and imperial counterparts, every point of health you take off of a sickle or off of another vehicle is going to be crucial. Because now the sickles, one sickle's already at half health, another one is already at one shot health. Already on fire in that red. Terror drone just gets fed right to them. The sickles are going to engage. He needs to engage those sickles, not the hammer tanks. If he just engages those hammer tanks, he's going to lose. It looks like it's about a roughly even trade. thereabout. Two tank busters do survive. One of them is heroic, but there are already two more sickles out to replace, like, the five that he just lost. So now, and then those two more sickles will be more than enough to take down the two remaining tank busters from the from Andre. These two tsunami tanks are still alive, though. They're still doing pretty impressive amounts of damage. Now, there they go. You just flip nano deflectors, boom, you get away. You know, I'd love to see these Imperial Warriors. Oh, Andre. And now that Terror Drone could get some free shots. It could lock them down. Wait, that Terror Drone's always gone. That Terror Drone is it. He has Terror Drones for ground defense right now. One Hammer Tank does come out. Does Andre know? Andre's got choppers. He has choppers coming in. Where are the Bullfrogs? They're on the other side of the base. Three Bullfrogs. One Terror. That's a scratch. Another Terror Drone. He's not going to have that four defense anymore if it comes down to it, unless he decides to rebuild it. Two Hammer Tanks already back out onto the map. If these Bullfrogs were to go away right now, if they were taken care of by the ground army, or if they were lured into an unfavorable engagement by these choppers, he's trying to sneak around. He's trying to slip around so that he can go get a Hammer Tank. Oh, but he does. He loses one. Will he lose a second? Yes, he will. Yeah. No MCV. Still no MCV. He's still running this off of just 2 ref. And same thing with Chris. It's just still running 2 ref. You sell that MCV and you don't rebuild it. He just is not rebuilding that MCV at all. And not rebuilding MCV, that could come back to haunt him actually pretty quickly. It could very well do that. 4 Hammer Tanks back out onto the map. It's really and truly, it's one of these players, I think, whichever one rebuilds an MCV first without letting the other player know about it. I think that's kind of what's going to dictate, you know, who goes where in for the remainder of this game. Because if Chris is able to get an MCV back online without Andre seeing it, then he'll mean he's set. You take one ref, you take a third ref, and boom, game's over. He'll have more than enough money to take care of anything that Andre can throw at him. Because right now, Andre, he's only on T2. He did retain the heroic tank buster from that earlier fight, which is, that's nice, that's really good. But and then that one lone chopper VX that's left over here. Then sending Tengu by Tengu. I don't know. Oh, that one is in heavy damage mode, so that is gonna slow down the mining efficiency. Oh, it's about to be dead. It's about to be more than just heavy damage. It is now dead. And does him fry the Terror Drone instantly. Listen, like the army, Chris wanted to move out, but he can't. Chris cannot move out, and that's very smart from Andre. He was trying to keep the micro, just stay out of sight of that Terror Drone just long enough so that he could retransform his Tengu into jet mode and get it on back to base. 6 Hammer Tanks and 1 Terror Drone. That's what we're looking at here. War Factory's not even rebuilding anything. As he can. He has to wait while he gets this collector back up. He has to wait, and he's stalled. He is so cash stalled right now. He is strapped for cash. If Andre attacked right now, if his units were in position right now to hit this refinery, I don't think he realizes how good of a position he would be in right now. He outnumbers the Hammer Tank count. There are more Tsunami Tanks on the field than there are Hammer Tanks. But that's about to not be the case. And then you have this one Heroic Tank Buster, yes, but it's about, and then one Chopper VX to top it all off. But now, going to engage, 6 Hammer Tanks, 7 now, the 7th now joining the ranks. This is going to be an all-about position. This is going to be a very technical engagement. All about positioning. If Chris can lure Andre, the two worst positions for each opposing player. It would be horrible for Chris, or it would be really, really bad if Chris took an engagement, or if Andre took an engagement right here. If Andre took a fight right here with a concave of enemy units around him, or really the same principle could apply here to this choke point. Because now he's charging into a choke. He's charging into a choke, and that is one Tsunami Tank already dead. charging it straight into a choke point. One and two hammer tanks will be traded for it, though. That is two hammer tanks for the price. Three hammer tanks, four hammer tanks. Hammer tanks are falling left, right, and center. He's trying to go for the bullfrogs. I don't know if I agree with that. I would just say focus on killing what you can, killing those hammer tanks before you worry about anything else. Is there anything else? You have to keep your ground firepower alive, which he cannot do. I think those shots he wasted on the bullfrogs are going to come back to haunt him. Because now two hammer tanks do survive. That's not good. That is very, very much not good at all for Andre to see. Andre, that means... Oh, now he has a heroic bullfrog. That's something that is every Empire player's worst nightmare, seeing a heroic bullfrog going at their air units, going at shooting, ripping their Tengu straight out of the sky. The DPS on a heroic bullfrog is just astronomical. Oh man, like with the Imperial air units being more lightly armored than the other air units in the game. I mean, it's really no surprise at all, right? It is absolutely no surprise to see that it's such that, you know, heroic bullfrogs are going to be such a problem. Really, heroic anything is a kind of a problem. That if it's heroic and it shoots up, it's kind of a problem for the Empire. But, you know, Empire is still very versatile. But we'll have to see, can Andre make this happen? He's going... I don't know if I recommend that. Even, I mean, me, back when I played this game on console, because I first played this game, first got it on my Xbox 360. When I first played it there, I mean, I was all about the Chopper VXs, right? Like, Chopper VXs, that's exactly how I would sneak up on somebody. That I'd make them think I was going to go hard ground, and then just boom, instant transition over to Chopper VXs. Problem with this, though, is it's Fred and Alfred over here. See, like, Fred, that little gold star next to his name right there. No, not Alfred. I'm going to call him Bob. Because Bob's like 60% broken. Fred and Bob here, they're going to be the problems. They're going to be some serious problems for those choppers, and they've been spotted. That terror drone getting its money's worth, it just spotted everything. Chris knows they're coming, already building additional bullfrogs. Already. And that heroic bullfrog is already going at it. And look at that, already down like 40% of his health. Just one, not even a full second involved in that flak fire. And already about 40% of that chopper's health pool has just been evaporated. I do like what he's doing here. Oh, but he's got to be careful. He's going to lose one. Will he lose two? No. I think the others will get away. Oh, but he has more than enough bullfrogs to cover all of his sides. I know what Andre is trying to do. Andre is trying to get to he's trying to pick and pull, right? He's trying to force his opponent to each side of the base. He's just trying to force his units out of position, right? He's trying to force Chris to accept and to take a really bad fight. But right now, there's six bullfrogs on the field. There are as many bullfrogs as there are Chopper VXs. Then, oh, you forgot about those. Oh, it has to panic hit the F key. Now that Terror Drone's just going to go straight at it. That Terror Drone's going to see if he can get any lockdowns, going to see if he can catch any of them. He is going to catch this heavy damage one, and now with those bullfrogs right there, there's no way. That guy, he's done. He's pretty much dead. Then he's just going to infect him and finish him off himself with that Terror Drone. What in the world is Andre going to do? Is his refs are about to dry up. He's about to be out of money. And actually, as a matter of fact, so was Chris. Somebody has got to give. Somebody make an MCV, dang it. What? No, actually, that may not be necessary, because looking at these armies that are coming... Oh, I think this is... Oh... Chris has a death ball. If this death ball makes it across the map without being detected by Andre, that's GG. This death ball will put an end to anything and everything that's inside of the Imperial base, which I think he's just going to go. He's too far forward. He's just going to come in. Now, I mean, Andre could try to do a bit of a base race,
and say if he wanted.
Oh, pardon me. If he wanted to, he could send his choppers back to Chris's base and see what he could have happen. That is not going to be very possible as they are currently engaging the front lines on these hammer tanks. He's trying to be very efficient about how his choppers engage. He did take down a lot of those tanks, but there's still two left. There's two left, and one of them is heroic. The tsunami tanks can't match that. One tank at a time? There's no way. You can't match that. Oh, is that tank gonna stay alive? No, it's not. Okay, so one heroic hammer tank is all that remains. And just look at that black fire. Everything is just falling out of the sky. Only one ref, that's it. Andre is gonna give the tap out GG. Well, he may not be saying GG, but I will say it for him. We will say it for him. That was a GG and a tap out from Andre. Very nicely played. Both players, you two are stubborn. Chris, Andre, if you guys are watching, you guys are freaking stubborn. Not wanting to rebuild an MCV. You know, I mean, I guess in hindsight, you didn't really necessarily need to rebuild an MCV to make that happen, as Chris just showcased. You don't really need one. I mean, I think the stalemate could have broken a little bit earlier. Had somebody built an MCV. But here, I mean, they both just went on two refs the entire game. The entire game, just two refs. Right? Just that two ref setup the entire game. But here, Chris, despite that, Chris taking a little bit of damage economically in terms of lost mining time, in terms of destroyed refineries even. I don't know if he ever destroyed a refinery. Andre did, but I mean, despite that, despite being at the economic, you know, having a little bit of an eco advantage, which I mean, you could argue 2900 to 2500, it's not that big, but you know, for a 20-minute game, yeah, I guess it's not really all that big, but every little difference does wind up counting, does wind up making some kind of difference. But still, Chris still managed to turn it around. He played really defensively, and he was able to take only really the best engagements that he was able to really dictate, like, right? He only took the engagements where he could actually, where he was in control and said, hey, you're going to fight me on these terms. He is, you know, trying to take a fight where he knows he is going to have the advantage and position himself to do better in. And that will conclude game number two. So without any further delay, let's jump straight into game number three, which brings us to the map. Infinity Isle spawning on the right side as the orange Soviet player currently up 2-0 in this series. This is H2O Chris. And the now blue allies player spawning on the left side and currently down, I was trying to say as the allies player, but I had already mentioned that, down 0-2 in this series of King of the Hill. This is Neversmurf, aka Andre. Andre switching it up for his final game. Which I mean, I think honestly, I think he switched it up from Empire just because he was able to, just because Chris was already able to win the last two games. So really and truly, I think this game, since this was taken from King of the Hill, this game, and Andre was the reigning champion at this point in time. He was the defending king. I think at this point, the who gets the title of King of the Hill is kind of already decided, since Chris has won already the best of three. That's kind of already going to dictate, say, like, hey, you know what? Chris is going to be the new King of the Hill. So this game, I think this game is just kind of for like a, I don't know, maybe just kind of like a derp around kind of match. Or I guess it's there just to kind of showcase the, or just to kind of be prepared for an ace match should it come up. But Chris does have the distinct advantage here. Chris did grab his oil derrick. Andre did not grab his. Not grabbing them at all. Instead, he's opting for a very fast third refinery, deploying his MCV back here on the beach, and we'll go ahead and place it on down right there. Chris moving up to the cliff with some bullfrogs in escort. Gonna see about taking out these vindicators with a very nice micro from Andre, dropping those vindicator bombs, getting a lot of damage off, and then manually telling his one of them make it caught. Okay, he doesn't want to have those Vindicators out in the skies for too long? Because I'm pretty sure that, you know, eventually they'll start, since they've already dropped their payloads, they will start taking damage the longer that they're in the air. I'm gonna be very careful, and they can't go back to base either. Yeah, take notes. Take notes, everybody. If you're watching and you want to know how to defeat an allied player that goes fast first airfield as Andre is doing, then this is exactly how you do it. You get out some bullfrogs, you just go camp their airfield, and boom, both Vindicators done and out of fight. Is this Sickle going to commit to kill this Prospector? I think he is. I don't know. I don't know if he'll be able to kill it. Oh, it's going to be tight. Gets it. Prospector is down, but that means this Sickle is going to die as well from these Riptide ACVs. Nothing really that he can do about that one, that Chris can do about that one. Seaport is down for Andre. What is he going to do with that? We don't know. Maybe. We don't know what we're going to find out. Could we see some Assault Destroyers? Possibly, but, well, no. No, because the MCV is up here on the cliff, but also no, because he just sold it. So, I guess he only built it just for these Riptides. Andre's now going to see about securing his oil derrick with that placement of the boot camp. Third ref online for Chris, but fourth ref, I'm sure, soon to be online here once he actually starts queuing the thing and starts building it. There it is. He's going to be getting his fourth ref here on the cliff face, and now all of a sudden, you know, Andre again is going to be in eco. He's going to be in a nice eco position. And now airfield of his own coming out from Chris. I think Chris is just kind of going to take this game as a little bit just like a relaxing kind of moment, you know. I think with the series being as it is, Chris really, unless I've misunderstood something along the line, maybe I just forgot something along the line, I don't know. Already basically having one, he's just kind of going to mess around. But Chris is going to go straight, he's just going to go straight for a fourth refinery down here. Just gonna go straight down and completely forget and ignore the one that's back there behind his base. Twin Blades are gonna be chasing off these Riptide ACVs. That is no bueno for them, as those Twin Blade gunships will hound them until the end of their days, which the end of their days is right now. It's down they go. Now we are coming out for Chris. Andre sold the seaport though. With Andre selling the seaport, then suddenly this naval yard, this naval yard stands to do quite a bit of damage if so much as one Akula sub comes out. That is bye bye refinery, bye bye power plant, and suddenly you're back down to three ref. That would be very, very bad indeed. Looks like we are gonna have a bit of a creeping turret push. The MCV gonna be seeing about moving up bit by bit by bit. These two hammer tanks are going to be enough. It looks like to eventually wear down that multi-gunner turret. Those war bears are going to be charging forward. Don't really even care about that fact that there's a multi-gunner turret just ripping them up right now. I think that multi-gunner turret is going to be able to kill off all of the bears. Yeah, it's definitely going to kill every single bear. And since not all the javelins are destroyed, Chris needs more bears. He needs more bears, like now. And there's another multi-gunner turret. There's another multi-gunner turret. That he needs to get on this. Like right now. He needs to get on and see about fixing it. Then, javelins, can they get it? Yes, they can. Barracks does go down already. Another barracks preemptively being built to be placed down, but it's gonna get laser locked. Immediately gets laser locked. A heroic conscript does come down. The javies are laser locking onto the MCV. They're trying to laser lock on the MCV. He's not going to be able to. Oh, that explosion actually really hurt. There's a sentry gun there. Go figure. The javelin trooper just kind of seeps slowly into the ground. Sentry gun does wind up killing one multi-gunner turret, but there's another multi-gunner turret here. It's already attacking the MCV again. This is Battle of the Barracks now. It's just Battle of the Barracks right here, right now, coming out. The javelin, the laser locked down a conscript, but the MCV from Chris does go down. Is Andre running out of steam? Does he still have some steam? I don't know. He may be running out of steam. Oh, Andre, he made a really nice push. What happened? But I think he's running out of steam in just a little bit here. Just a wee little bit. I think he is running out of steam. And these hammer tanks, that's forcing the cell off of that airfield. And there it was. The Akula sub did come out onto the water. And next thing you know, gone. That third refinery is now gone. But then this third refinery for Chris is getting laser locked down now. We have laser locking Javelin Trip, but that's just going to sit here and he's just going to sit right on it and laser lock it until it goes poof. And when that's... Now that'll take the score back down to 3 ref to 2 ref. Well, no, but now it's going to be equalized thanks to this army. They're just kind of mutually killing each other. 2 ref to 2 ref. There's no answer. There's no answer inside of this base right now. I mean, there's a sickle that's going to go see if we can lock down that Javelin Trooper. Oh, man. That sickle does indeed go down. These hammer tanks are on one refinery. Twin Blades are on another. That Akula sub can come over here and start killing that power plant. And, wow. Chris is ripping the rug right out from under Andre. Andre had a really strong push, but I just don't think he has the juice to keep it going. I don't know. I mean, Chris might be in a little bit of money trouble right now, but if he doesn't really have it, Andre has two airfields. I don't know why you need two airfields when all you have are three bombers. You have three bombers. Oh, wait, no. Never mind. He has two of all fighters. Never mind. Ignore the fact that I cannot see what is directly in front of me. He does sell off, looks like a boot camp or two. Trying to get in, trying to build whatever it is this airfield is building, which it's probably another Vindicator.
Why on earth,
I don't really see the reasoning behind using your cryo shot like that. I mean, sure, you could position Vindicators to try and do something with that. But that was actually a very nice micro. Three of those bullfrogs do wind up going down. Then, if that has any damage on it, which no, it doesn't. Oh no, those Vindicators have got to get in the air. If they don't get airborne, now it is over. If they, one Vindicator per target, and I do believe that will be all it takes, yes. But now there's four hammer tanks. These hammer tanks are going to go completely unanswered. I think we are looking at the end of the game. That is one of the last units for Andre. Complete three heroic hammer tanks. This is over. The sell-off is happening. Are we going to see a sell of this power plant? Most probably. Andre is officially out of the game, which I forgot to mention at the beginning of this game, that this game was actually a replay between these two, because Andre, I believe, forgot to submit one of the games when it was submitted over to GameReplays.org, and as such, that game that was not submitted was void, so these guys had to play again, and this was the rematch that wound up making the series a best of three, but Chris does wind up taking the game 3-0, counting this replay game. Chris just skyrocketed on eco. He just skyrocketed on up. Even with Andre having 4 ref to 3, Chris just skyrocketed. Chris did get another ref that was down low on the low ground of Infinity O. So that was a good call, good play from both of those players. 10 minutes and 49 seconds, that's actually not that long of a game at all. Yep, eco very much so. About 14,000 worth in favor of H2O Chris, and he used that money to devastating effect. Andre, I mean, I think he had a really good push, but it just ran out of steam. I think he just ran out of steam on that turret push. If he had a little bit more time, he didn't lose all of those Javelin Troopers to that little pack of 5 War Bears, then I think suddenly that would have turned out a lot differently, I think. Or it had the potential to turn out differently. If all of those Javelins had survived and they were still putting damage out on the unit of the defending units of Chris during that turret push, that game could have easily ended a lot differently. But, you know, that's just shoulda, coulda, woulda. Everything is in hindsight, or everything in hindsight is 20/20, or hindsight is 20/20 vision. There's a saying about that. Like, everything in hindsight, you know, makes more sense. But there's a saying somewhere. I can't recall it right now. But thank you guys so much for watching. I do hope you have enjoyed. It feels so, so good to be back. So, 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 so good indeed. As a matter of fact, if I can at all help it, I'm going to see about knocking out King of the Hill over the next few days. But do note that, as I stated, as I mentioned at the beginning of the video, I am back at university now, so I'm taking summer courses here. And with that, I'm not taking as many, but that also means that I go to each course every day since it's a shorter semester. So I do have work that I will be doing every single day for university. But despite that, I do have a nice little time slot for recording that every single day, so I can guarantee pretty much make a video every single day now that I'm back into this routine. So be sure to stay tuned for more casts to come to the channel as guests, as I am now active again. So as always, guys, thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. And this is Sniper signing out.